Hello, and welcome to our webinar, Youth Authors and Arcs. I'm Sarah Hunter, Books for Youth and Graphic Novels Editor at Booklist. Before we begin, I'd like to go over some technical details. A link to today's title list, which includes NetGalley and Edelweiss links to eArcs of all the titles presented today, was included in the reminder email you received from Zoom 1 hour ago. To download it, please open that email, scroll to the bottom, and click on the link located there. You can also download the title list by copying the URL on this screen into your web browser. If you have any trouble accessing the title list, please contact us at webinars@booklistonline.com. The audience is in listen-only mode, but we welcome any questions you may have. On the bottom of your screen is a toolbar with a section for Q&A. If you have a question or need technical assistance, simply click Q&A and type your message into the box that appears. We will do our best to respond to all tech-related questions, and we will pass along all other questions to today's panelists so they can follow up with you after the webinar. Last but not least, Booklist offers closed captioning on all webinars. To enable or disable captions on your screen, please look for and click the live transcript icon on the toolbar mentioned above. From there, you can select show or hide subtitles from the menu that appears. If you choose to enable subtitles, you can adjust the size of the captions at any time by selecting subtitle settings. Today, we have the pleasure of hearing from Stephanie Keen, author of We Weren't Looking to Be Found from Disney Publishing Worldwide, JL, author of A Taste for Magic from Bloomsbury Publishing, Tasha Spillett Sumner, author of Beautiful You, Beautiful Me from Owl Kids, Hallie Edelman, author of the Way Past series, including Way Past Lonely from Albert Whitman, and Ken Nimura, author of Never Open It, the Taboo Trilogy from Yen Press. Our webinar will begin after a brief presentation from each author, immediately followed by a couple of questions about their book. First, we'll hear from Stephanie Keen. Stephanie is a psychologist and an author. She has written 5 novels for teens, including Charm and Strange, which won the ALA's 2014 William C. Morris Award for Best Debut Young Adult Novel. Stephanie lives in the San Francisco Bay Area with her family and their many pets, where life is loud, joyous, and filled with animal hair. Thanks for being here, Stephanie.
Thank you. I'm really excited to be here. I really appreciate the opportunity. And I'm excited to talk about We Weren't Looking to Be Found, which, as Sarah said, is coming out in June with Disney. And this is my sixth novel for teens. And I think I have a reputation for writing sort of creepy thriller mystery type of books. And so writing this novel was a little bit of a departure for me. It's just really a straightforward exploration of two characters, teenage girls who are dealing with issues having to do with mental health, family, growing up, adolescence. There are no murders or cults or deadly acts of betrayal, which made it like a very raw and visceral experience to write about it. Just a very personal book about these two characters. So we can switch to the next slide. So this is the description that's on the back of the book, the back cover. And as you can see, it's a story, yes, about two girls who are very, very different people. They come from different ethnic backgrounds, different class backgrounds. They have very different values and personalities, different expectations of the world, different understanding just of who they are and what the future might possibly have in store for them. And then this book really is about them bringing them together at a crisis point and what happens then. So I just wanted to talk a little bit today about how I thought about these two characters and then what it means to sort of what it meant to me in terms of the story and bringing them together. So go to the next slide. So the first girl is Dani, and she is from Texas. She's from the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And she is a very extroverted, outgoing type of person. Her family is also very prominent. They're exceptionally wealthy. Her mother is involved in local politics. And she sort of seemingly has it all in terms of wealth and opportunity and educational opportunities. She's beautiful as a boyfriend, a car, kind of everything that, you know, maybe a teen that age could want. But she's also sort of struggling because her family is very image conscious. Her mother is very controlling about the image that their family presents to the public and sort of how perfect it has to be. And Dani definitely finds that hypocritical and believes her mom has sold out, and ends up defining herself by becoming oppositional against what her mother wants. And sort of in rebellion, in a way to escape that, she ends up partying too much in ways that she doesn't really appreciate the consequences that are happening. And then the next slide. And then the other girl is Camila, who is a very, very different personality. She is a dancer. She lives in rural Georgia. Her father is Colombian American, and kind of there's some intergenerational trauma having to do with who he is. And she is an only child. She lives with her parents, who are sort of, middle working class, but a sort of a very non-confrontational type of family. They don't talk about things. They don't focus on things. So very different from Danny's family, just sort of an avoidant, quiet family that has its own stresses that aren't really spoken aloud. And Camila is very focused on dancing and using dance as a way to get out of this town that she grew up in and doesn't want to be in and sees as a dead end. And as such, she just has become this perfectionist. Everything has to do with her dancing and her body and what she can do to control these opportunities that she has to get out and to make something of herself through dancing. She holds all her emotions in tight. She has a history of self-harm, but she also has this dream of going to a New Jersey dance academy that she thinks is going to be her way out of this town. She also doesn't want to disappoint anybody in her life, especially her parents. So the next slide. So the way I sort of conceived of bringing these two girls together and what the story and like their conflicts might look like, I really kind of, you could sort of see here, this is sort of how I thought about what are their core identities and features and ways of expressing themselves, ways of acting and ways of thinking about themselves that inform how they behave. So Danny, she's the one who escapes through substance use and denial. She doesn't believe that she has any sort of problems. Everyone else is the problem. Everyone else, is kind of, they're fake, they're hypocritical. She's just rebelling against that. And her core identity is independence, being the observer. She sort of sets herself outside of everything and being that external critic. Where Camila is this perfectionist who self-harms and ultimately attempts suicide. And she understands that she is in pain, but she doesn't believe that that there's a future for her that doesn't have pain. Like that's what she needs. She needs to suffer in order to get what it is that she wants. She's internalized that around dancing as well as like what it'll take for her to escape. And her core identity is, she's very self-protective. She's aloof. She's emotionally inaccessible. Her emotions are really repressed and she's very controlled about how she behaves and what she lets other people see of her. Go to the next slide. And so in different moments of crisis, these two girls both end up at a psychiatric treatment facility in Georgia that's called Peachtree Hills. Obviously they're sort of thrown together. They become roommates. They have very little in common, although they do find that they're both like the two non-white patients who are at this facility. So they do have that in common, but they're very, very different personalities. As I said, and they do chafe against the restrictions of this facility and the circumstances under which they were admitted and whether this is really a place that can help them. They sort of go through different periods of believing whether that kind of change is possible or under what circumstances that change might happen. But I will say too that they're like, I wanted to make this facility like it's not an immediate crisis place. It is a longer term type of facility. There's also discussions kind of around the class and money it takes to even access that type of resource. So that's also part of it as well, like trying to deconstruct a little bit of what this facility is and what it means to have access to this type of mental health treatment. And go to the next slide. But ultimately the story is about these two girls becoming friends, trying to understand each other, trying to learn how to support each other and what that means to each of them in their own journey towards healing. And I think a lot of my writing and a lot of, I mean, I'm also a psychologist. My work as a psychologist has to do with these questions about what does it mean to heal? How does it happen? What does it look like? Like, what's the difference between like intellectual insight? Because you have someone like Dani who's like very smart and can observe and understand things about herself, but that's not the same thing about being vulnerable and like allowing herself to be, you know, part of a system that she may feel is hypocritical. And well as both girls sort of understanding that healing and health are ongoing processes, they're not destinations. And that ultimately that it's finding meaning through sharing an experience with another person, with having a friend and what that relationship means. And I think I'm just about out of time. So that is where I will stop. Hopefully that gave a little taste of what the book is about.
Thanks so much, Stephanie. That was great. So you alluded to this a little bit in your description, but it seems important that neither Dani nor Camilla are white. And I'm curious about why it was so important to you to shine a spotlight on the mental health issues facing not white teens.
But I think part of the way just conceptualizing it is just like, these are the people who come to treatment and need help. And I don't know that that's always represented in like different media that we see. I think that there's more and more. I mean, I think there's really some wonderful YA books that is becoming more and more, but also just in terms of who we're seeking, you know, mental health treatment and resources right now in terms of teenagers, it is a lot of, you know, girls of color. And just coming from the field of psychology, it was not always like developed to have a deep understanding of how to work with you know, people from different backgrounds and different experiences. And so exploring that as well as, you know, hopefully offering hope, I think, to girls of color, I mean, and all teens about what kind of change and hope is possible is really important to me.
Yeah. Do you think there are more or different societal pressures on teens today than there have been in the past? Or do you think we're just better at seeing those struggles in our current era?
Well, I think there's absolutely more. I mean, they're also changing, and it is hard for me as a very much not a teen right now to, you know, speak with like a lot of authority. But just, I mean, social media in and of itself has, I think, really, really changed things in terms of like how public and accessible people's lives can be, even if they don't want them to, and the implications of that, that feels very overwhelming. And I can't really imagine what that must be like. Plus having just this like nonstop escape from the social world, right? You can't just come home and oh, things are turned off. It's always there, it's always happening. And that inescapability to me feels very overwhelming. And so I can only imagine. I think it's been significant. And, you know, obviously the pandemic and other things are their own stressors.
Yeah. So you mentioned your professional background in psychology, and I'm curious if from the perspective of an author, whether there are some YA tropes that you think get teen mental health wrong?
I mean, I'm sure there are. I also think, I mean, you know, there's tropes and ideas just in general life about mental health that people get wrong. I do think, like, again, there's so many more wonderful stories being explored in YA around mental health and just different experiences. That's not just one experience or just like one, you know, problem of the week kind of narrative. I do think kind of one of the biggest things I struggle with, and this is not like YA or a particular book or author, but just like our idea of what we think stories are and what they deliver is this idea that like there's a reason, right, for everything that happens. There's a beginning, we can explain it, there's a theme, we can look back and see the seeds or the foreshadowing. And that feels very satisfying, you know, when you get to like, oh, I get it, like it's come full circle. And of course, like life and mental illness and things like this are not like that. And so I think this desire to have like a why and to understand why is just sort of a narrative pressure and expectation that is hard when you're trying to write about things that are much, you know, have many different aspects to them that really there aren't necessarily whys in that story.
I'm curious if you find, I feel like we're probably getting close on time, but I just have to ask you this question. Do you feel like your understanding of mental health and mental and emotional growth is like fundamentally at odds with your role as a writer crafting narrative?
I don't know. I mean, it can be. I do feel that pull, like to understand why. And I think people do too. I think sometimes that is why people come to therapy, is to understand why. Like, why am I like this? Why am I this way? And whether that's there's an answer to that, it's just a question to ask. And so I think the question, I mean, I tend to think of writing as I'm asking questions. Like, I don't know the answers. I really rarely do. And I rarely come up with the answer as I'm writing it, but like, what does this mean? What does it mean to think about? What does it mean if this is this way? Or what does, what does change, maybe look like or doesn't look like? Or how do these things impact that sense of what it means to change? And so yes and no, I think. But I think it's also something that like comes up as well in therapy. Like it just is in the world. Like this is how we think of stories and how we understand things. Is we want answers. And sometimes the hardest thing is like sitting with the fact we don't have it. So.
Yeah. fascinating. Thank you so much. Next, we're going to hear from, hold on one second here. Here we go. We're going to hear from JL. JL is the author of Taste of Magic from Bloomsbury, and she is the New York Times bestselling author of the YA novel Wings of Ebony and an advocate for marginalized voices in both publishing and her community. Born in Houston, Texas, Jess has a Bachelor of Journalism and a Master of Arts in Educational Administration and Human Development. Her passion for empowering youth dates back before writing to her first career in education. She's worked as a preschool director, middle school teacher, and high school creative writing mentor. In her spare time, you'll find her volunteering at an alternative school, providing feedback for aspiring writers, loving on her three littles, or cooking up some dish due to her Texas and Louisiana roots. Take it away, Jess.
Hi. Hello. I'm going to share my screen, in theory. Okay. If someone can give me a thumbs up that you can see that would be super awesome, just so I know it's there. All right. Yay. Okay, I see the chat. All right, so I am going to make myself smaller and I'm going to talk just a little bit about myself very briefly because that's boring. And I'm going to instead talk about A Taste of Magic. So I am JL. I am the New York Times bestselling author of The Wings of Ebony duology. And I'm super excited to be here to talk about A Taste of Magic, which is my middle grade fantasy debut, which is out August 30th of this year with Bloomsbury. So jumping right in, what is A Taste of Magic about? A Taste of Magic is about 12-year-old Kiana, right there on that adorable cover, who learns after her 12th birthday the family secret. It's that she's a witch. Now, Kiana lives in a very like regular neighborhood. I want you to think we're grounded in a very contemporary world here. And she lives in an inner city community, much like mine where I grew up. And she finds out she's a witch. And not only is she a witch, but she's enrolled in Saturday Magic School in the back of her hair salon. So this entire time there's been magic in her hair salon and she just never noticed it yet. In fact, there's been magic in her entire neighborhood and she hadn't noticed it yet. And so I think the fun part of the journey obviously is like seeing her go into magic school and what that's about. And then as challenges arise, for example, gentrification begins to sort of threaten the school's ability to thrive. And so it's actually notified that it has to be shut down. And so it's fun to see Kiana kind of fall in love with this place and begin to see her community in a new way and realize that there is magic right where she is, like in her community, in her neighborhood, in her everyday places. And it's really, really fun, I think, to see her be faced with the challenge of, oh no, we're going to lose this thing that's really special about our neighborhood here. What can I do about that? I love Kiana's heart. She's super sweet and funny, but she's also like not the most confident student, like academically. Her best friend is math club president. She has a C in math only because her best friend tutors her every Sunday at the library. So I just love that you have this very imperfect character that I think kids will relate to, and you get to see her find out through this journey what's special about her, and that can be different from what's special about someone else, and that's okay. Some of my favorite like words to describe A Taste of Magic would be enchanting. I think it's really sweet, and like the magic is a lot of fun. Magic schools are super fun and certainly not new, but I think this being the very first magic school in an inner city community to ever exist was just so much fun to write, to think about how magic can exist in your everyday. And I think sort of the undercurrent of that reality, like what does that mean to a kid to believe that their neighborhood, where they live, particularly in an inner city community like mine, is magical? It's full of diverse rep, which I really love. I think it's very hilarious, though I'm biased, but there is just lots of like laugh out loud, funny moments. And I am a mom. I have three kids. They are very much like in this age range. So the middle grade age range. But I also was a teacher and I taught fifth grade, sixth grade, and a little bit of seventh grade writing. And so I was thinking about that age and I wanted to make sure that like if parents are reading their books, because I know like on the fourth grade side of things, sometimes fifth grade, sometimes parents are still reading these novels with their kids. I know my mom and I would read the summer reading list that we would get every summer. We would read those books together in elementary school. So I took a tip from sort of like what the Pixar movies do, where it's like, there's humor for the kids, but then they put these little nuggets of funny in for the parents too, because parents are obviously watching. And so I tried to make it laugh out loud funny for everybody involved. I mean, it's quite ridiculous and incredibly adventurous. So I thought I would talk a little bit about what inspired this series. A Taste of Magic is book one, so it is an actual, you know, series. It's a few things, but to start, I grew up in an intergenerational family. In my household, so first of all, my parents were not together. So my mother raised me as a single mother, and Kiana's mother is a single mother as well. And Kiana's grandmother, her Mima, as she calls her, lives with them. And Mima cooks all the time, but Mima's mind is not what it used to be. I grew up in a family with my mom. This is actually my father's mother, which I'll talk about in a second. Both of my grandmothers are blended into this story, but I just think there's such amazing there's just such amazing beauty in intergenerational families. And I don't see those represented, at least when I was a kid, I didn't see those represented in books that I was reading. And so I wanted to create and write this world that I wished I had as a kid. And so in my life, I had my mom and then my mom's parents, and they were much older. They adopted my mom. And so I was like in high school, my overseas, like the people in charge of me were like in their 80s. And so it was just really fun always like helping out with things and like being relied on, because grandma can't get down that heavy thing off the counter. Like she should not be climbing a ladder, you know? And so I played with that in this book because Kiana's mother works a lot. She works around the clock all the time. And so her Mima is home and they do all the cooking together. Similar to me, her grandmother gets sick with dementia. And so her memory starts going, but cooking is their thing. So one of the really cool things that Kiana gets to do is she gets to memorize the recipes. And then she gets to tell Mima. Mima will say, how much of that sugar do I put in if they're baking a cake? And she'll get to tell her like, oh, it's 3 cups or whatever. And so it's just kind of their thing. So they do all the cooking and like the kitchen cleanup and kind of take care of the house together. And Kiana's mom is in and out at work. So I tried to, again, bring that reality to the page and weave it in. I don't want to spoil it, so I'm not going to tell you how, but like weave it in very specifically to the plot. Another example of what inspired the book is the richness found in inner city communities like mine. These are pictures taken in my community. This is actually me. This is actually me in front of an area in Third Ward of Houston, which some people who have no idea anything about Houston or Texas have heard of Third Ward now because of George Floyd. George Floyd grew up in Third Ward. I grew up in Third Ward. That's where my family is. My mom went to the same high school with George Floyd around the same time. So like my community is very near and dear to me. And there is such richness there that I feel like so rarely did I see it in books when I was a teacher, or when I was little, when I was reading middle grade stories. So I wanted to bring that richness to the page. One of my favorite questions is, how did you come up with so many like fun, magical ideas, like a magical mini mart? And there's like a little restaurant in the neighborhood that has like all of these little magical features. And I was like, well, I was just writing what already exists. Like there's so much magic in my community. And so I just felt like I was bringing that to the page, giving it language and putting it in a story. And then I would say the other piece is, as a former educator and a mother of three kids, working with kids inspires me. That's what keeps me inspired. I love it. And the more that I work with them, the more inspired I am to to tell stories that really just like pays attention to how much they know. Kids are very perceptive. And I think that's what I learned most from being an educator. They are picking up on a lot. And so that's sort of where this was born. And then again, it's out August 30th. Here are a few fun blurbs from Daniel Clayton and Kwame Mbalia, whose work I just adore. And I think it's a lot of fun. I think I'm low on time though. So let me see if I should stop sharing my screen because I think there are some questions. Am I too early? I have 1 minute left. Okay, I think I did okay.
You did great. That's one more minute for me to ask you questions. So you've already, as you mentioned, written some YA novels. What made you want to write for a middle grade audience?
I just have more to say. No, like honestly, I taught that age, my kids are that age, and there was just something about wanting to tell stories and just like tell stories that didn't exist when I was that age. I feel like right around third grade is when I fell in love with reading, and third, fourth grade. And I see my children are 11, 9, and 7. And so I see that happening for them. I see the wheels turning. And I just had this desire to like write to that space and write stories that I wished I had at that age.
Very cool. So magical schools are an evergreen trope, as you know, in middle grade fantasies, but yours really stands out. Can you talk a little bit more about your approach to the setting of the novel and what was really important to you to include?
Yeah, so magic schools, again, I think are really fun, but I've never in my life read an inner city magic school book. The idea conceptually that there is magic in an inner city community, I had never seen done. And I think when we really sort of break that down is whether I put on my parent hat or my author hat or my teacher hat, that is incredibly profound for a child to realize that they can look outside of their circumstances and like look and find like magical pieces of their community in their life. I'll talk about it a little bit more later as we talk more, but I think there's just this beautiful parallel between sort of the gifted kids that I grew up around, just the beautiful richness of like togetherness and like the whole concept of it takes a village. I feel that in my community, and I wanted that to like bleed on the pages of a story because I think that literacy is a gateway to upward mobility. And it was for my family. I grew up very poor. I was the first in my family to go to college. I was the first in my family to graduate from high school. And I think those things were possible because of my love of reading, which was really instilled in me at an early age. But I find when I was a teacher and even now, sometimes not being able to see yourself in a story or see the things that are nostalgic to you can create a barrier for readers to connect. And so that grieves me that there are kids not falling in love with stories because they don't see their lives reflected. And so it was important for me to create a magic school that was accessible to everyone. It's important, I think, for every kid to understand that they are magical. Mm-hmm.
You're right that there's something really powerful about finding like a little source of wonder just over your own shoulder instead of in a faraway magical land. I remember being really moved by books that felt close and immediate when I was a kid too. So you've mentioned your work as an educator and an advocate for youth. How does that influence your writing choices in particular?
You know, it's a constant reminder that books change lives. Like I think, you know, so we talk about inclusion and diversity a lot. And I think that while race and gender and ethnicity are really important conversations to have with inclusivity, I think just looking at how books mirror the fact that kids live in all different places and their lives look different, right? You have kids who live in the city, you have kids who live on farms, like all of those experiences, not just sort of their ethnicities and their identities, but their experiences, like the music they like, their favorite food. Like, I think when you center those things, you like affirm their humanity. You affirm that their existence matters and is valuable and is okay. And I think the absence of those things says the opposite. Like, I think the silence is actually very loud. And so it was important for me, I think, to, as I think about like my kids and the kids that I worked with when I was a teacher, just the things that I wanted growing up, to try to speak to those things in like as I construct stories and try to put books on shelves that are different from and like reflect a different reality than other books that I've seen. I think another unique way that I try to approach this is and I was kind of mentioning this earlier, is I think that fantasy is particularly powerful because it enables you to picture what you can't see. So, and I think there's something incredibly powerful for a person, potentially for a person to be able to, for kids to be able to envision things outside of reality. Because I think that there's something really contagious about that. It's like, well, if I can imagine this and if I can imagine that, then what if I could imagine a future for myself that I don't see right now, or that I don't see anyone around me with right now? You know, I think that that can be very, very inspiring. And so it's important for me to sort of bring that fantastical element to my stories while also making them accessible. I found fantasy was hard for me as a kid because I didn't know what it was like to be on a boat. I didn't know what it was like to go to the ocean. I was an inner city kid. Like, I did not know a lot. So I didn't find the actual subject matter relatable in some of these fantasy stories. I never traveled to Europe. Like, I struggled imagining. And so when I approach my magic systems, I root them in the contemporary world, in the familiar, so that the book is very accessible to contemporary readers. The fantasy readers get their magic and contemporary readers get to feel grounded and like not lost. And I think that helps the readability of it.
Cool. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. So next up we have, we have Tasha Spillett Sumner. Tasha is an Inuit, Cree, and Trinidadian award-winning poet and author who is also working on her doctoral degree in Indigenous land-based education. She makes her home in Treaty 1 territory, Manitoba, where she raises her daughter, Isabella, with her husband. She is the author of the New York Times bestselling picture book, I Sang You Down from the Stars, and the award-winning Surviving the City graphic novel series. Thank you so much for joining us today, Tasha.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone, and happy Earth Day. I'm just going to begin with doing a traditional introduction. I just find it places me, and especially on Earth Day when we, you know, just give thanks and reverence to Indigenous people who have kept the earth in such beautiful and meaningful ways. So watching a Totemek Wapi Mameasquan Degasim Wapi Masquan Dodem, and it's always just speaking my own ancestral language really places me. It reminds me why I do the work that I do and who I'm accountable to, the people and the places that I'm accountable to. If you could just jump slides, please. So that little face you see on the screen is my daughter, Isabella Gishgoyabik, and she's bigger now. She's 2 years old. But when I think about the stories that I create, you know, both the Surviving the City graphic novel series, I Sang You Down from the Stars, my first picture book, and Beautiful You, Beautiful Me, which we're talking about this afternoon, I always say that, you know, I write with the purpose of writing into existence worlds that are worthy of my daughter. And I think that for, you know, especially for BIPOC authors and creators, That's our part of the medicine that we give is to create worlds or bring into being worlds that we know the people who have survived in our bloodline so that we can be here today would feel worthy of us. And we do that the same thing for the ones still coming. Can you jump sides, please? So I Sang You Down from the Stars is really a love story and a love song between a parent and a child. And the purpose of that story was just to remind myself and to share with other communities that the teachings that we have as Indigenous people that speak to how children arrive in the world. And as a new mom, JL was saying that she's a mom of three, and I'm like, wow, you look incredible for a mama three. I was like, that's very inspiring for being such a prolific author. But myself as a new mom, we know that it's so important to remember, you know, how children come into our lives, the purpose of children in our lives and our communities. I Sing You Down from the Stars is really about remembering for my own cultural tradition that children pick their parents. That before a child is born, they see each and everything that their life will be, and knowing all the strengths and the struggles, they choose as their first act of agency to pick who they're born into. You jump slides. And then we get to Beautiful You, Beautiful Me. And so I'm an Afro-Indigenous person. I have Trinidadian and African heritage from my father, my father's line, and an Anishinaabe Indigenous heritage from my mother's line. And I was raised by a single mother. And I remember looking at my mom, you know, looking at myself and looking at my mom and just seeing the physical differences between us. And you know how a little girl looks at her mom like that's just the most beautiful person to have ever walked the earth. I remember seeing those differences and being like, well, hey, like we don't match. And then my daughter came to be, and she is also looks physically different than myself too, with her deeper chocolate skin. And so part of my own responsibility, feeling my own responsibility and stepping into, you know, as BIPOC people, we are the experts in our own experiences. So who to write our stories better than us? I wanted to write about, you know, the experiences of multiracial families in a really, I hope, a really sweet and simple and beautiful way. When I think about people reading this story, I think about those tender times at the end of a busy day that my daughter and I share, where, you know, everything around us kind of fades away and it just becomes about her, me, and the story. And the story really, even though we're reading the words, the story can change for us depending on how our day has been, the particular meanings that we want to pull from the story. And so Beautiful You, Beautiful Me comes out in fall, this coming fall. And I'll just read a little bit about the description. Izzy, which is my daughter's name, Izzy's favorite place to be is in mama's arms, skin to skin, safe and warm. One night cuddled up in mama's lap, Izzy noticed something she's never noticed before. Her skin is the color of chocolate, but mama's skin is the color of sand. When Izzy realized she's different from mama in other ways too, she feels sad and confused. She wants to be beautiful like mama, but mama addresses Izzy's disappointment with a gentle, loving refrain. You're part of me and I'm part of you. I'm beautiful like me and you're beautiful like you. Finding lessons from nature and repeating her affirming message, mama encourages Izzy to see her own unique beauty. And I hope that for all our children, I hope that in the beautiful ways that our families manifest, that our different bloodlines manifest from generation to generation, for families that have, you know, unique configurations, adoption, and other ways that families come together, I hope that children really feel celebrated on the page and see their own families and themselves reflected back to them in really beautiful and dignified ways. And so I would like to take questions now.
Lovely. Thank you for that. Our daughters are the same age. And I was thinking a lot about that when you were introducing your book, and that's very meaningful to me too. I also am very impressed that Jess has three children. I don't know how I can handle having one sometimes.
I know, toddlers are something else.
So tell me a little bit about the parts of your book that were inspired by your own family or experiences. I know you elaborated a little bit on that, but I wonder if you could talk more.
It's definitely, this is a little bit of a love song and appreciation for my own mom. She did her best. You know, she raises, like I said, as a single mom. So we were raised within the Indigenous community. And because our father wasn't present, we didn't really have that strong connection with the Black community growing up. Mm-hmm. But my mom did her darndest to make sure that we had, you know, rich Black stories to read about, Black dolls to reach for. She did her best to make sure that we were always had positive representation around us. And I think that, you know, I really honor that about her. I really honor the fact that she really wanted to celebrate the ways that our, you know, our the physical manifestations of our heritage, you know, whether it be our curly hair, our darker skin. And so as a mother now, looking back, I have such deep appreciation for the work that she did to make sure that we grew up with a strong sense of identity. Mm-hmm. And also just, you know, knowing that I want to do that for my own daughter too, knowing that you know, I want her to walk through the world knowing that she is beautiful, that her, you know, her cultural features are, you know, to be celebrated. Even when we know that sometimes our children don't get that messaging outside of our home. So I felt like it was really important for me to, you know, contribute to the body of work that exists to ensure that, you know, children of color, you know, grow up with a strong sense of positive identity.
Yeah. So you do a lot of work in the field of Indigenous education, and I'm wondering how this book ties into your work elsewhere.
So I'm doing the silly thing of trying to get a PhD. it's a work. It's a definitely labor of love. And so I feel like I have two brains. I feel like I have the brain that is working on, you know, producing this academic work, and then the brain that produces children's literature and young adult literature. For me, I like, as a community member, as somebody who knows that, like, at the end of the day, the amount of people who will likely read my dissertation is like maybe my PhD committee and my mom, which is like six people. I feel a deep responsibility to move the knowledge that exists there into a place where it can be mobilized and transferred to many different people who can access it in many different ways. And so my graphic novel series, in my picture books, it's taking out the real gems that are coming from the literature, that are coming from, you know, the deep academic intellectual work, and weaving it in or seeding it in to places where it can be, you know, picked up and gathered by many different people wherever they are in their own development. So for me, it's like, it's cathartic. It's you know, it's about like responding back to the responsibility that I have to my community to produce work that actually, you know, can be accessed easily.
Yeah, it's like a practical application of your research.
Yes.
Great. So picture books are so often a shared experience between adult and a child. And we often talk about what children can take away from picture books. But given how many adults will inevitably be reading your book, what do you hope that adults will take away from your book?
You know, I hope that, you know, in every adult is that child that wished for something. You know, we carry around the child within us that, you know, wished for something to be different, wished for something to be more. And so I hope that, you know, especially for multiracial adults who maybe didn't grow up in areas where our own identities were reflected back to us in positive ways, I hope it eases or comforts those tender places in adults who still carry with them, you know, an inner child who has wounds about our own identities not being affirmed in the ways that we deserved and should have been.
Mm-hmm. You're never too old for your inner child to be validated.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Tasha.
Thank you.
Okay. Next up, we have Haley Adelman. Haley is the author of numerous books for children, to better the lives of children and family through education, story, and film. With a PhD in education, she has taught elementary through university students and was nominated twice for the Disney Teacher of the Year Award, and she also produces documentaries. Hallie lives outside Philadelphia, Pennsylvania with her family. Take it away, Hallie.
Great. Hi, I'm so excited to be here. Thank you so much for having me. I'm going to share my screen. It was very exciting to listen to Stephanie, Jess, and Tasha and hear about their beautiful, unique, and funny books, some funny. So I'm excited to learn along with everyone today and to share my presentation with you. I'm deeply committed to writing for kids. Here are a bit of the books. First, I'm just going to give you a general overview. I am the author of the Great Big Feeling series. The series itself started with Way Past Mad. The illustrator is Sandra De La Prada. She does a beautiful job of bringing feelings super close and zoomed in. And I think that's one of the things I really try to do with the series, is really zoom in to a child's world, to a very specific everyday situation and really bring feelings and heart to the page in a way that it's very accessible for kids. Way past mad, the situation's as simple as this little girl who's leaving for school right after like her morning gets messed up by her sibling. Her room's a mess from the sibling. You know, the sibling eats the rest of the cereal. So really simple, simple pieces. And to match that simplicity of the world that these children are living in, I'm also trying to match the simplicity with language. So for example, it's like I flung open the screen door and called bye, but my family was too busy to hear me. I headed to school kicking rocks and sticks as I walked, kicking and kicking and kicking. I was way past mad, the kind of mad that starts and swells and spreads like a rash. And I really tried to infuse a lot of sensitivity and support in the books, and obviously big feelings, you know, other small situations, small examples, you know, a little boy named Brock in Way Past Worried, who was excited for his best friend Juan's superhero birthday party until he realized his favorite sidekick that he normally goes to parties with isn't going to be there with him. And then I try to ask big questions like, well, what does it feel like for Yaz, whose best friend Debbie is getting all the attention in Way Past Jealous for her drawings? Debbie's drawings of dogs are so amazing. The teacher puts them on the board with a big old star on it. And Debbie's jealousy just builds and builds and builds. And I try to do that in the whole series, Way Past Sad, with a little boy, James, whose best friend's moving away, and Lonely and Afraid, we'll talk about in a minute, but really just the question of what does it look like for a feeling to build, get out of control, and what do we do with those feelings? In addition to those titles, I do have other titles. My Quiet Shit was my very first book that I wrote. I grew up in a household with a lot of yelling in the home. So My Quiet Shit's a book about a little boy who hears the yelling in his home. And when he does, he pretends he's gonna be the commander of his quiet shit. And he uses his imagination. And one day the quiet ship's broken. And it asks the question of, well, what can he do next? Can he admit to his family that the yelling just makes him feel scared? And then The Strongest Thing, which I'll also talk about in a little bit, which was actually a story that came from a grandmother who wrote to me after I wrote My Quiet Ship, saying that there was more aggression going on in her grandson's home, and what kind of book could be there for that? So I really asked myself what would happen if the strongest, something that felt like the strongest thing felt big and mean and angry and hard for kids. What if the definition of the strongest thing changed? What if they could see that the strongest thing could really be calm and gentle and loving? So these are the three most recent titles, Way Past Lonely, Way Past Afraid, are part of the Great Big Feeling series, and The Strongest Thing. So as part of Way Past Lonely, a little girl who's in, again, an everyday situation, her best friend's away for the weekend and she's feeling lonely, she's by herself, everybody seems busy. I decided to go to the playground, but it was like I was invisible. I was way past lonely, the kind of lonely that starts like a seed and grows like a weed. And what's important to me is for kids to start being able to see certain tools, kids to be able to see, like she's gathering sticks and weeds and leaves and she's sitting on her giant throne, swinging her legs and humming in tune. Being alone felt good. So I love it when kids can get to the point where just in experiencing their everyday life, they can figure out how to shift a feeling. They can even try things and make mistakes. So in the books, one of the things I love doing is really the idea of I am, right? I am, we want kids to be able to I identify their feelings, A, acknowledge them, M, manage them. So really going through the journey of kids being able to say this, oh yeah, I'm feeling that way too. And then really being able to learn some tools to manage them. The other thing I love happening in the books is kids making good mistakes. You know, we don't want kids to feel when they're dealing with big feelings, like they have to be perfect. You know, in Way Past Jealous, Yaz actually pulls her friend's drawing, sneaks into the classroom, pulls her friend's drawing down off the board for the stars of the week and hides her friend's drawing at first. You know, in Way Past Mad, Kia actually, like, she tells her friend she doesn't even like him when she's really mad. like taking it out on other people. So how can we allow kids to make good mistakes and show them what resolutions look like, so they have healthier alternatives for dealing with feelings and they can feel like, huh, maybe there is a better way for me to handle this big feeling. I like to also say, like, look there and learn here. Because in like way past afraid, for example, you know, it might be easier for a kid to say, you know, gosh, I feel afraid when there are thunderstorms, by seeing the main character in the book, by seeing Van go through it, rather than having to say it out loud themselves first. So how can we show kids that someone else, a character, so there's a little bit of a distance from the feeling, to give yourself and give kids the comfort in really expressing that they might feel that too. And also I love to show that real is complicated. You know, when you're feeling worried, your mind might be racing. You might be worried about small things like your costume, like all of a sudden Brock gets worried. So really just asking yourself the question of all of these different, how can we be real with kids and show them like, you could be mad and worried and confused and lonely kind of all at the same time. What does it look like to just be super honest? And as I said, the new books are Way Past Lonely, Way Past Afraid, and The Strongest Thing. This is from Way Past Afraid. And it's, again, like I said, these two siblings on their way to sleep at their grandparents' house, and all of a sudden there's a storm outside. I tried to hum to stay calm, but the strong winds whooshed away my hat and the sky got even darker. Hurry up, Abby. We ran through rumbles of thunder, grum, trum, trum. I was way past scared, the kind of scared that makes you feel stiff and small and quiet. It was like there was a storm inside of me. I hugged Pops hard. Van's afraid, Abby said. Nothing that cookies and kisses can't fix. Gran's cookies were warm and good, but they didn't stop my scared, and they didn't stop the storm. And I love showing kids, like, and adults too, sometimes we say things to kids like, oh, just get up, you're fine, or the cookies are gonna be perfect. And they are comforting, but maybe they don't stop the feelings inside. And I really try to show kids, like, even when you're figuring out how to get through a feeling, sometimes one way to get through it is to know that you're being brave even when the feeling's still there. You know, and Way Past Worried, we talk about what does it look like to kind of be a superhero even though you're still feeling worried. And here are just some pages from The Strongest Thing. This is illustrated by Rhea Zai, and Lonely and Afraid were illustrated by Karen Wall. And again, just showing kids that the strongest thing was calm and kind and so much stronger, just like me. So I'm gonna stop the share because I'm at time and I'm really excited to connect with you, Sarah. Thank you.
Sure, great. Thank you for that presentation. It's nice to see some inside spreads of your book. So how do you choose which SEL topics to focus on in each one of your books?
For me, I mean, I've been really lucky to work with Albert Whitman and such an amazing team. I'm currently working with Sue Tarski as my editor, and I'm really lucky that we kind of dig deep. Way Past Mad, some of the books are really just inspired by the kids around me, by my past experiences. So, you know, watching my nephew kind of like stomp his way when he's feeling bad and he's having this big feeling really was the really very easy to choose Way Past Mad first. You know, Way Past Worried, the team talked about, and it was cool because my daughter would want to go to a birthday party. And when she'd go to a birthday party, if her friend, she wasn't driving with her friend or it was hard to walk in. So I think it really is just coming from the kids, my experiences, their experiences. And I taught so many kids. I taught elementary school. So really just paying attention to children and what they struggle with when they have a really big feeling.
Yeah. Speaking of your work as an educator, how has that informed your approach to writing the books?
I think one of the things it allowed me to do is do a lot of beyond, not just on the writing side. I wanted the build for kids and showing kids how things can get big and how they can get small again, creating a sense of calm. But also I love creating a lot of beyond the book activities. So I have a website, waypastbooks.com, where I'll try to create, like, what does it look like to make mad cakes? Can you get your mad out using, you know, by making like a simple recipe? You know, what other activities can we do? Can you, if you're feeling jealous and that's because you're feeling small on the inside when someone's getting all the attention, can you make star shades and like strut yourself around to remember that like you're still a star just for being you? So I think the educator piece helped me, and not just being sensitive to understand how to communicate with kids and how to use really simple language, but also in the activities that go beyond the book.
Cool. So SEL is a relatively big buzzword in kids publishing right now. I've got two parts to this question here. Why is it so important in our cultural moment or our current moment? And what is the mark of a good SEL book? That's my second question. You can pick whichever one you want to answer. Sure. Well,
I think why it's so important is, you know, I think it's always important because we want our kids to be successful. Mm-hmm. And being able to manage your feelings is important in being successful in relationships and in the world and anything you're going to do. And I also really believe that feelings connect us. You know, they're universal. We might not be able to fully understand each other's lived experiences, but we can certainly understand how it feels to be lonely. We can certainly understand how it feels to be worried, how it feels to be mad, how it feels to be sorry or guilty. So I find that feelings are a really good way of bridging our world, bridging relationships, communicating with each other, and connecting with each other. And as far as what marks a good SEL story, I mean, for me personally, I believe it's honesty. Mm. You know, I like I said, kids and parents in the book kind of making mistakes. Like, how can we be honest? If we want kids to learn to manage things, like, not to, instead of presenting these perfect scenarios and these perfect situations, you know, how can we show the imperfect? How can we show that, you know, it's hard to manage feelings? I get calls from adults and messages from adults like, oh my gosh, I really needed that book or whatever, because we all still do, you know? And even, and I also think the other mark is allowing things to present an option for kids and not the answer for kids. You know, all kids aren't going to respond the same exact way. So how can we show them what one character does and put in a lot of samples of ideas for them, but then really trust that our kids are very, very smart. They have really special ideas on their own.
Yeah, yeah. Kids definitely have a lot of agency and capability. And I feel like the best children's books that I read are always sort of honoring that part of kids' reality.
Yeah. Cool. And Sarah, I do want to say that if any librarians, I do have a surprise swag pack for anybody who wants to DM us at Way Past Books. There's a librarian stamp, there's socks, there's a book magnet, and then some swag for the books. If you want to DM at Way Past Books, book list, ALA, then I'll know to reach out and send them something. So thanks to everybody for being here today. And thank you, Sarah, for interviewing me.
Cool. Thank you. All right. So our final presenter today will be Ken Nimura. Ken is a Spanish-Japanese cartoonist and illustrator. He's the author of Henshin Umami, the 2018 winner of the Eisner Award for Best Digital Comic and Never Open It. He's also the co-creator of I Kill Giants, written by Joe Kelly, which was adapted into a film in 2019 starring Zoe Saldana. Ken Nimura's work has been translated into 12 languages. He lives and works in Tokyo. Because he lives in Tokyo, Ken was unable to make the event live today, but he was kind enough to send us a video. So without further ado, take it away, Ken.
My name is Ken Nimura. I'm a cartoonist and illustrator. I was born in Spain. My father is Japanese, my mother is Spanish. So I've grown up between both Spain and Japan. So Never Open It, it's a book, it's a collection of three short-ish stories that are inspired by, there's this Japanese tradition of legends, you could say, that are called mukashibanashi. The same probably as, you know, for the West, like Grimm tales or Perrault or others. And so it's a very vast selection, I mean, group of legends that go from epic tales to like comic stories. Most of them, you know, younger kids know them through like their parents, like reading through like children books and everything. And there's been one specifically that I've always been interested in, that's called Urashima Taro. And that one, it's a story about like a small young fisher kid who saves a turtle one day, and then in exchange the turtle takes a kid who's very poor to this like underground palace under the sea. And then he spends several, what he thinks are several days enjoying, I don't know, great food and having fun over there. And then suddenly he feels homesick and he wants to go back home. And so the princess who lives in that palace gives him a box. I'm gonna make a spoiler, sorry. But you know, it's a very well-known story and it's very short. So, and so she tells the kid like, you have to take back this with you, but you must never open it. So the kid goes back home and then realizes that instead of like 3 days, it's been maybe hundreds of years that passed. His family is no longer there, neither his house or anything. And so he's desperate. And in desperation, he opens a box. There is like smoke coming out, and then he turns into like an old man. So he's caught up the years that he spent under the sea. And then ends. He tried to think like what could have happened if instead of like this tale being a tale created to like pass on an idea, if we thought the story from the point of view of the kid himself. So if I were him, or if we were him, what we would we have done actually, instead of like being, let's say, sacrificed for the better good of like passing on a message. And so I reworked the whole like story based on that idea, and it also happened that I tried to present it to a Japanese publisher as a kid's book, and I was like, it's Urashima Taro, but it has a different ending. And they liked it. They were like, yeah, we get the idea, but we cannot show this kid. Like, if we're gonna show kids a version, it has to be like the official version in a way. And that's when I decided to make it into a comic. I work, let's say, the Japanese way, if you can call it that way, which is in Japan, comics are, or mangas are made not from the script, like a written script, as you would have on for a movie or a theater play, but rather what they, the storyboards, what they call here namu. And so what you do as a comic art, as a cartoonist, is you're doing like sketches where you're combining both texts and images, and you're already doing the breakdowns on like where each panel goes, which is a lot of work at the beginning, but it helps you really see how the flow from one scene to the other works. So it's a much more natural way of working, considering that, you know, cartoons are both, comics are both, like in a you know, combination of images and words, that it's very difficult to separate one from the other. The lines you see on the comic aren't inked, it's pencil, it's just pencil. So this one that I have over here, a Tombo Mono 100. And what I like about working with pencil is that it's very intuitive. It's very, and you can actually correct very easy, which is like if I make a mistake, I just like erase with an eraser and go back and draw, which is pretty much the same process as probably when you're working on digital and you can do Control Z and go back. First version I did for I think it was a children's book. I did like the storyboard, and I decided like, oh, for the scene where the princess saying like, do not open the box, I go like, what if I put the box in red for now as on the sketch, just to remind myself the box is very dangerous. And that kind of like stayed over the different versions I did of like that storyboard. And then at one point, although I tried to make a colored version out of the comic, I was like, no, it's actually by using this like red color for like super specific moments that I am finding the most effective. In the making of the book, I did lots of research about like these legends, and it was lots of fun because like there are so many versions out there, especially being able to go and look at books like here in Japan and in my local library. There's a wide selection of like same Urashima Taro, same Crane Wife, just different approximations. Like one of them, you know, the age is different, or maybe a certain story beat works differently. And so what I did was like, I let's say mapped out as many possible different versions that I could find out there. And if anything, like distill, you know, what were the common points that were absolutely in each one of the legends. And as for the rest of the small details, which were like maybe one character change, that's a different thing in one story or the other, I just kept them as like possible, I don't know, possibilities that I could draw from where the original tale would end. That's really like a midpoint for me. And that's, if anything, like the plot point that propels the story towards the real end. And so that's where I add like a second half, which really talks about like, well, specific themes that I think are of interest for myself. Whenever I write a story, I'm, if anything, just like trying to put myself in the shoes of the characters that are in there. And then just, if anything, trying to just convey to people, let's say me as a human being in a certain specific corner of the world, if I were in this specific situation, I would maybe feel, or I would maybe behave or do this thing. And by putting that into a book and making it available for other people, if anything, what I really want to just say is like, me, I'm a human being, I thought or felt this, how about you? So Never Open It, it's currently available on book form, and I'm assuming also like digital download. So hopefully, you know, you'll be able to find it somewhere in your local, either bookstore or library, or, you know, at home from your iPad. So hopefully if you get to read it, I hope you like it. And either way, have a good day.
Thank you so much to Ken, Haley, Tasha, Jess, and Stephanie. It was such a pleasure to hear about your new books today. On Monday, all attendees will receive an email containing links to today's title list, certificate of completion, video recording, and a link to these fantastic e-arts. For more about Booklist webinars, be sure to visit www.booklistonline.com/webinars, where you can view archives of past webinars and register for upcoming ones like those you see here. Not yet a subscriber? Pair the print reading experience with the convenience of online access at booklistonline.com and lock in print, online, digital, and archive access by taking advantage of the special webinar offer to get Booklist for only $75. Patron-friendly, librarian-approved, and free with the Booklist subscription, Booklist Reader, Booklist's new digital-only magazine highlighting diverse readers' advisory recommendations for all ages, has arrived. To see and share the latest issue, visit booklistonline.com/reader-issues. And we are very excited to share that Booklist, Booklinks, and Booklist Reader recently joined the Overdrive Magazines program in partnership with Zinio and are available for your librarians to read in Libby. Thank you again for joining us for today's webinar. And one more huge thank you to our authors and to our sponsors, Disney Publishing Worldwide, Bloomsbury Publishing, Owl Kids, Albert Whitman, and Yen Press. This concludes today's webinar. See you next time.